Welcome to all, and hope you're staying safe and warm this winter. I'm Emily Newman, Education Coordinator of the American Humanist Association. So thank you for joining our monthly series called Speaking of Humanism. We all know the 2020 holidays will look and feel a little different than previous years, but they have the traditional delights and disputes each winter season brings. To share in his experience and give some advice, we're excited to welcome our speaker, Janey Rizvi, tonight. He is a founding member of the Oasis Network. He is a Pakistani-American and former Muslim who became a humanist in 2007. Janey served on the Houston Oasis Board of Directors for 7 years in various capacities, including marketing, governance, finance, and as the board secretary. He serves on the marketing committee for the Oasis Network and is a contributor of Oasis Gaming. So we're gonna hand it off to you to speak. And then remember, folks, if you're on Zoom, you can type in your questions to the Q&A feature. And if you're on Facebook Live, you can use the comment section and we'll get to them after the talk.
Thank you very, very much, Emily. Thank you very much to the American Humanist Association for having me. And especially this time of year, it's a great honor for me to be here for you, with you for your December meeting. I wanna make sure that I get ready properly for our talk today. It is the holidays, so I wanna keep it a little more festive than usual. Today is also Human Rights Day. So we might have some heavy topics to discuss, but that's just because that there are important things going on that we are involved with. As you heard today, I work with the Oasis Network currently as the secretary. And the Oasis Network, for those of you who may not be familiar, is an organization of secular communities throughout the US and Canada that meet on a weekly basis to get together and do something very similar to what we're doing right now. Get together to hang out with our friends, to have a good cup of coffee together, to listen to live music, and then have some interesting talk on a different topic every single week. Now, during COVID, that's pretty challenging. So we are doing everything very virtually right now. And those events that are in person are outdoors and distanced. We are obviously secular and we do trust science. So we are following the instructions of our scientific community here. So today I want to talk to you a little bit about how humanists celebrate the holidays. And it is also Human Rights Day, so we're gonna talk a little bit about that. And what a strange time for us to be talking about the holidays and celebrations when in the background right now, once we actually hit Christmas Day, we will have crossed, unfortunately, 300,000 Americans who've lost their lives to a global pandemic. With our country being so isolated from the world that we're not able to travel and other people are not able to travel and spend time with us because our numbers are so high from the pandemic. So many of the people that are an important part of our lives and are ourselves have lost their jobs, are underemployed, forced into a retirement that they weren't ready for, that they weren't planning for. People are going through a very tough time right now. And even more frustrating than that, it feels like as a society, even during a difficult time like this, even in the holidays, we cannot seem to agree on how to go about dealing with these things. We can't even agree on the basic facts, which can be so incredibly frustrating. Some people think that COVID isn't even a serious problem. A lot of people deny that COVID death numbers are even COVID numbers, or whether it's just some liberal conspiracy, whether we should be masking or not, whether we should be in large gatherings or socially distancing, or whether or not we should take a vaccine when it becomes available. We are in such polarizing times, which presents a great difficulty for so many people. There are people who are going to celebrate the holidays this year for the first time without one of their loved ones who they've lost this year. it's going to be incredibly difficult for those families. Some people are going to be spending the holidays alone during this time. Especially because if we're doing more distancing and doing more virtual things, people feel much more isolated. And of course, we can't forget the communities that have struggled with police brutality this year that find it very difficult to celebrate, wondering if their lives are valued and important here in society. So that is the backdrop of holidays 2020 that we are in. And I'm here in the state of Texas. In Texas, we annually kind of drudge out the war on Christmas. You know, the rhetoric kind of starts showing up around this time of year. If you're at work dealing with the public, it's always a big question. Do you say happy holidays? Do you say Merry Christmas? Is somebody going to get offended? All of that kind of weighing down on people can be really demoralizing during this time of year. It feels like we've taken a lot of steps backwards, and there's so much frustration on the part of humans and humanists and Americans at this time of year. So, you know, what's a humanist to do this holiday? Hopefully we can talk a little bit about that and even share some thoughts together. But my main message today is that I think that if we really stay focused and stick with our humanist values, that by sticking with those values, we will come out ahead, that we can succeed in our challenges, and we can have celebrate a good holiday and feel like we're doing the right thing. So I want to give you a couple of examples of this here. So normally during the holidays at Oasis, we like to say that human hands solve human problems. And every year during the holidays, our communities organize and give back to our respective communities. So we do that through a lot of volunteerism. I've enjoyed very much with my local Houston, Texas chapter, serving at the George R. Brown Convention Center to prepare meals for the less fortunate during the holidays. I have enjoyed getting a chance to deliver Meals on Wheels with the friends of ours from faith-based communities as part of an interfaith effort on Thanksgiving. And every time we do these service projects, we always get asked, are you guys some kind of church? I mean, I really like the idea that as secular groups, we are pushing back on this idea that you have to believe in a higher power or you have to be some kind of religious organization to be good. And the work that the American Humanist Association and groups like Oasis are doing really push on that. It's a little bit tougher to do that now during a pandemic since there's more distancing involved. There are ways to serve our communities. It's also really important to very deliberately do events where we are able to interact with each other. It's very easy to get isolated during times like this, especially when we're at home, especially those of us who feel it's important to do our part during the pandemic and stay socially distanced. So Oasis communities are continuing to do weekly gatherings, and most of them virtually. Particularly for the holidays, one of the things that's heartening for me is one of our chapters is called Oasis Gaming. And Oasis Gaming is an organization that we've formed so that, you know, secular people around our organization and outside of our organization can come together and have fun and play games together. A variety of games. It can be board games. It can be video games. And just hang out and have fun. And so right now, Oasis Gaming is hosting holiday movie events and holiday game nights to bring people together. Some of the things that we really want to be able to do in person that we can't do, and Oasis Gaming is giving a platform for people to do that and for people to come together and feel like it's the holidays. It's also Human Rights Day today. And so I would like to sincerely extend some gratitude to the American Humanist Association. I believe just yesterday, the House of Representatives passed House Resolution 512, which was an effort that was led by the American Humanist Association, as well as a coalition of other secular organizations, that calls for the repeal of global blasphemy, heresy, and apostasy laws. Round of applause to the American Humanist Association for taking a cause that's so important and championing it for the American people. I was really concerned. I was hoping that it would pass with, I wanted to make sure that a lot of people supported it. And it looks like it was a resounding victory there, which is huge for us. Interestingly, today, the State Department also released a list of countries of concern regarding their human rights and their religious freedom laws. And countries like Burma, China, Eritrea, Iran, Nigeria, North Korea, Pakistan, Saudi Arabia, Tajikistan, and Turkmenistan. And of particular interest to me, because I am a Pakistani and I am a member of the Pakistani community, anytime Pakistan makes a list like that, it's always of interest to me. You know, many people who might be watching today may not be familiar with South Asia or the Pakistani community or even the Muslim community, but it's been an important part of my life, and I think it always will be. Pakistan is a place where there are a lot of unfortunate violations of human rights, and unfortunately, there is a lot of religious extremism there. Pakistan is a place where religious minorities struggle significantly, even minorities that are various sects of Islam. And if a majority feels insulted by anything that's said by any minority, that can easily result in violence, which is a very tragic situation. Here in the United States, especially here in Houston, you know, the Pakistani community is a wonderful community. They're a well-organized community. And when they come together, they always want to do something positive to give back and to help Pakistan make the important advances that are necessary in order to deal with issues like this. And I want to tell you about one instance when the Houston Pakistani community invited a social activist to come and speak to our community. And this activist's name was Gibran, his name is Gibran Nasser. And Gibran is a young man who is a social leader in the country, and he stands for human rights, for equality, for there to be fairness in society, and for equality for women, freedom of religion, and generally is someone who is a voice of reason in the Pakistani community in Pakistan. And so when he spoke here in Houston, he told our community that as a man, as a male, and as a member of the majority sect of Islam, he felt it was his responsibility to make sure that minorities and people who are traditionally disenfranchised have an opportunity for a better future and to have equality in Pakistan, and that the future of Pakistan needs to be one of equality and human rights. It was an incredibly inspirational and uplifting moment here for our community. And it's important for me to tell you that the Pakistani community and Muslim communities in general, especially here in the US, do a lot to make things better over there. I kept following Gibran, and I watched him actually run a political office in Pakistan. I watched his stump speeches. I watched his campaign events. I followed him. And for each time he would go out, he would say that, you know, obviously, all the things that are important to a society, like their healthcare, their infrastructure, their education, the things that the political leaders want to talk about. And each time he would say that, a group of the most religiously extreme people would say, well, we're interested in listening to you if and only if you are willing to condemn religious minorities, or that if you're willing to condemn minority sects that are blasphemers. And he wouldn't do it. He said to them, I am not here to run for office because of my religious views. I'm here because I think that we need better education, better healthcare, better infrastructure. We need the electricity to be on better. We need to clean up air pollution around here. We need to make sure the water is clean. And a person's religion doesn't make any of those things better. If a person's religion did make those things better, it would have already been done by now. That message resonated with a lot of young people in Pakistan, the following that he has. But once the election was over and the votes were tallied, Gibran Nasser won 7th place in his local election. So that's kind of like the SpaceX launch yesterday to me, you know? Yeah, the Starship took off and it kind of took flight, but it crashed and burned on its landing. I want y'all to know that the Pakistani community, especially, you know, those of us in the West, we see something like this and say, this is the is progress. And we've got to build on that. We've got to keep going. A little bit later, a news story came out of a very tragic story of a young girl, 13 years old, who was taken from her family by a 45-year-old man, and they were entered into a wedlock, and obviously the parents were mortified by this. And the reason the story took off is because the young 13-year-old girl, she was her family was Christian. They said that she converted to Islam, and then the 45-year-old man married her, meaning that she didn't have to go back to her family anymore. She had a new home. It doesn't take a genius to see what's going on here. This is an incredibly troubling situation. And things like this happen very often in this region of the world. But what a lot of people didn't realize, especially the Christian community across the world, shared this story with utter outrage, and I believe rightfully so, and it became very viral. But what they haven't done is they haven't followed up on that story. That family ended up getting helped by Gibran Nasser. That same activist that came here to Houston ended up pro bono taking on their case to help win back the rights of that 13-year-old child. And they didn't just go after the 45-year-old man who violated that girl. They went after the religious organizers and the political leaders that certified that marriage. They went after the people who gave refuge to these people, knowing that something so tragic had occurred, and are really fighting against these injustices in Pakistan. Today, that young 13-year-old girl, she is in a shelter home. So she is no longer stuck in that situation, in that horrifying, tragic situation. And there are charges against the 45-year-old man. And this is just one small step of the many that are necessary in this part of the world to win human rights. But it's very important for me today to tell you, as a Pakistani person, as a secular person, Muslim people did this. Gibran is a Muslim person, and he took on this case. And the Muslim community in Pakistan overwhelmingly supported this case to bring that man to justice for what he'd done. This is something that everybody wants. And kind of fighting for our values the way that we have, we can work with people of faith all over the world to advance human rights. And it's an important role because there are a lot of people counting on us. I'm really proud to see that people from my community are leading this fight. And I'm really proud to be a part of the American Humanist Association, which here in the US is leading and championing this fight. So let's keep that up and keep that in our hearts this holiday season. I also want to say a few words about how spending time with family during the holidays can be a little bit difficult. You know, it was a lot easier when I was a child. You know, I obviously religion was a default selection for us at that point. And even our Muslim family here in the US, we'd wake up on Christmas morning and there was a lot of red candy around the fireplace. It wasn't a big ordeal or anything, but it was a pretty good day. Our family didn't particularly celebrate Christmas. They saw that as a holiday for a different religious group. But as kids, we just liked the idea of Santa Claus and reindeer, snowmen, and all the stuff that kids love about Christmas. And my love for Christmas hasn't changed one bit. I have experienced everything that you could experience from a family dynamic. And many people watching here will be able to relate. When I first told my family that I didn't want to be a Muslim anymore, that was not taken very well. I ended up being disowned and the family didn't speak to me for a couple of years. And that was a very difficult thing. There are a lot of secular people that are actually going through that right now. And that's difficult for them. And I understand how you feel. By living my values, doing the things that I would normally otherwise do, I was able to reconnect with the family. People would tell my parents, they'd say, you know, your son, he's doing a lot of good things for the community. He volunteers a lot of time and makes a real difference here. And that's stuff I would have been doing anyway. I wasn't doing anything different. I was being myself. I was living my humanist values. But by living those values, I got a chance to have an opportunity to reconnect with the family. And now our relationship is very good. But as many of you know who have a very religious family, it continues to be a little fragile. Things can just go awry at any moment. I went to watch a movie with a couple of my family members one time. We enjoyed a wonderful movie. Came back to my parents' house, we're laughing and joking, and my parents were in a horrible, horrible mood. They were so upset, and we were like, what's going on? And they were like, well, someone called us from the community, and they said that they thought that you were in some kind of secret marriage. I said, a secret marriage? They were like, yeah, of course we told them that's not true, but we just hate that people are talking about you. And it really upsets us. So I told my parents, look, Mom, Dad, I haven't done anything. I mean, not today. I haven't done anything today. I'm definitely not secretly married. And for those of you who are wondering, this is actually a thing, okay? Secret marriage is an actual thing that happens in our community. If someone wants to marry someone and they don't want the community to know about it because it would bring embarrassment or shame, maybe they weren't the right religion or they weren't from the right community or culture. Yeah, there are people that have secret marriages, but I'm pretty open about how I feel about these things. So I didn't feel any need for any secrecy with them. But those are the kinds of things that can happen on a whim, just out of nowhere. But then there are also some very, very good days. The way that I feel like I've been able to kind of facilitate better interactions with the family is quality time. I know that Christmas holidays are a lot about gift giving. And I do think that there is something majestic and awe-inspiring for a kid to tear open a wrapped box. I know how that made me feel. And a lot of folks want to enjoy that feeling as well. But it's the memories of time spent that I think carry so much weight. I have a young niece, she's about 9 years old. And my sister always says to me, you know, you never buy her anything. And I say, I know, because I prefer spending quality time with her. We'll make cookies together, we'll make a pizza together. When we play, we'll play whatever she wants. I don't dictate to her what to play. Whatever she wants to play, we'll play. And you can't convince her that I'm not like the best person in the world. And of course, that's because I don't have to do any of the discipline stuff or be the bad guy or anything. Anytime she's fussy, I'm like, hey, mom and dad, it's your duty now. I'm out. This year, I wanted to have another one of those strong memories with her, something that she'll remember. And you know, she'll call back memories to me all the time. Hey, uncle, remember when we did this? Hey, uncle, remember when we went here? Hey, uncle, remember when we did that? And this year we're going to do something special. So she needs a new computer for school. You know, school's virtual for the kiddos right now. And so this year for Christmas, we're going to build one together for her. That's right. She and I are going to get together and we're going to make her new computer. And I feel that the process of making it together and her having it and remembering us going through that is going to be so much more meaningful than me just going and buying her some expensive thing from the store. And I think that she'll, when she uses it, it'll associate with that memory. And we'll be able to talk about it every time we use it. I'm very fortunate to be in a situation where things with my family have gotten so much better, where I can make memories like that. And I hope that you get a chance to focus not just on the gift-giving aspect, but the quality time aspect. And I hope that this holiday you get to connect with the people who are important to you. And finally, family is not just limited to the people that we're related to. I once remember a time when I had a particularly troubling day with my family. A lot of things were said and feelings were hurt, and I was bummed. I could not even hide it from my face how upset I was. And I go to Oasis that day, and we, you know, it was a good gathering, and then afterwards we always go and hang out for lunch. Well, we sit down for lunch and someone asks me, hey, Johnny, what's wrong? I feel like, you know, you're not yourself today. And I said, yeah, I had a really tough day with the family. They said to me, you know, Johnny, we're your family too. In that moment, I really needed to hear that. And it meant everything to me. This year, people across Oasis chapters are there for each other who are having a tough time. It brings me a lot of happiness to know that we've made friendships and relationships that are so important and valuable to us across our chapters, and that we can be there for each other. And there's going to be people in your life that are going through a tough time, and they need someone to hear that they're important to you. So I hope that you will remember those folks during this time. And it's amazing that during a pandemic that Oasis continues to succeed and continues to do well. We've added chapters during a pandemic. We've updated policies and procedures. We truly feel like, as a secular organization, bringing people together on a regular basis to celebrate the human experience is the future. And I want to also have some time to talk with y'all. So I just want to kind of wind down here with a few important thoughts. I know how frustrating it is right now for a lot of folks out there for this holiday, but I want to just remind you, take a step back and look at the bigger picture. I do think that humanity is going to beat COVID. I think we are. We need to minimize the casualties along the way, but I think we're going to do this. And the world is becoming more and more secular. I know that sometimes it's hard to see that, but we objectively know that more and more people are embracing reason. And the more that happens, organizations like the American Humanist Association, organizations like Oasis, and people like us will emerge as leaders in society, even more so than now. And this is an opportunity for us, as long as we stay true to our humanist values and continue to do work that we know is good, people will see that these folks here are good without a God. And that's everything. If we keep that up, we're going to be okay. I hope that this holiday season, you get a chance to do whatever brings you joy and happiness. I hope you get to celebrate with those people in your life who are important to you. And let's also keep in mind all the folks that are having a really tough time during this pandemic. Let's make sure we reach out to them and let them know that they're important to us. And I think that we'll be much better off ourselves for doing that as well. So with that, I wanna give a chance to open this up, Emily. So let's kind of bring more people into the conversation. There may be some Q&A. I'm happy to chat a bit about some of the topics we discussed today.
Great, thank you so much for that talk. You got a lot of comments both here on Zoom chat and also on the Facebook section of people saying that they're excited to hear from you and that your niece is super lucky to have you. And some people relating to your story too as individuals connected to countries or religions where they wish there was more humanism in there.
Yeah, for sure.
And I did share both in Zoom and on Facebook a link to Oasis Network. Do you want to give your like elevator pitch kind of summary of Oasis and what people look for when they join a group?
Yeah, for sure, Emily. Thank you for giving a chance to do that. We'd love for y'all to get a chance to learn about Oasis at oasisnetwork.com. We've got a number of chapters throughout the US and Canada, and if anyone's interested in having a chapter in their area, they can also send us a message through our website there. We're not some kind of evangelical organization. We don't go around saying, oh, we need to dominate the world with these chapters. But what we do offer is for secular people who want to have a healthy, vibrant community that meets on a regular basis, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. We've kind of done a lot of that. So everything that you need, we've got ready to go. And we've got a lot of leadership and encouragement along the way. So leaders from across our network of communities are able to give you feedback, encouragement, and support. So the point of being a network is so that we're never alone, that we work together to accomplish all the things that are important to us. And that also makes our voice strong in our communities. So whether just as a friend or out of interest, we hope you'll take a look at the Oasis Network and get involved. And for those of you who like to have fun and play games, you can check out oasisgaming.org and come hang out and play some games with us, watch some movies with us. It's secular people having a good time with each other. So it'd be great to meet some new friends.
Great, yeah. And I'll mention that, you know, one of the reasons that we do feel excited to promote Oasis is because all of the secular and humanist organizations are working on strengthening our networks. So, you know, I also put in there the link to finding a humanist group in your area, and we invite our groups to connect with Oasis and Oasis groups to connect with us. Because as you said, like there are lots of us out there. Maybe we're not feeling certain labels or we're not super comfortable coming out at certain times, but we want to make sure that we have lots of opportunities to connect, especially during tough, cold winter seasons when it feels like we're very much alone and separated.
Right.
And we have, you know, some folks here on the chat actually are members of some of the local AHA groups. So we have one saying, I'm a secular humanist. I'm a member and co-founder of a local freethinker group. I also participate in a local interfaith group. I'm discouraged that the interfaith group fails to reach out to my freethinker friends. How can I help remedy this?
Oh, I feel you there. I recently participated in an interfaith event and the interfaith community doesn't know what to make of us, okay? We're kind of like the new kids on the block. They don't know if we're here to make trouble. They don't know if we're here to steal all their members. They don't know if we want to eradicate them. They don't know so they're kind of standoffish, okay? And I just want you to know that I've experienced that, but I also kind of understand it. I think that by working together with religious communities and religious leaders, we can form a good relationship with them, okay? And what I mean by that is, at Oasis, our content in our gatherings is, you know, we kind of started off as, well, let's talk about religion today. And then the next meeting, let's talk about religion today. And then the meeting after. But that kind of got old early on. So it's like, well, let's talk about something else. And we've been talking about something else ever since. Our content isn't necessarily about religion very much anymore. It's about life and the world. And we want to learn something interesting and new every time. That's not really very threatening to religious groups. I also think that it takes some time to build familiarity. I think that if we participate in things together over time, they'll be like, oh yeah, that's the humanists over there. They're all right. They don't participate in any of the religious stuff, but you can count on them to show up when you need something done. You know, if that's the reputation we build, what's going to happen is if someone from a religious community starts to express a dissatisfaction with their situation, what will likely be conveyed to them is, well, maybe you should go check out the humanist group over there. Maybe that'll be a good fit for you. Like, I honestly don't think that in our lifetimes we're going to eradicate religion or anything like that. So I feel like let's fight for their rights to believe and practice what they want, as long as it doesn't cause harm or infringe on anyone else's rights, and that we expect the same. And if we do that for each other, let people decide what's right for them. And that's probably a good place to start. And hopefully we can build on that. But as long as we live our values by being kind and being good, at Oasis, we say people are more important than beliefs. And that includes religious people. So as long as we live our values, I don't think people will see us as a threat. We eventually emerge as leaders.
Yeah, definitely. And I think, you know, sometimes in society, we get unfairly seen as the people just trying to take away religion and, you know, enforce our evil secularness out into the world. But, you know, separation of church and state helps both religious and non-religious people, because it stops a dominant religion from taking over and deciding on the life of everybody, whether or not they're, you know, connected to that religion. And it has so many different examples in policy and society that I think that especially now, any pushback on Christmas gets unfairly connected to being unpatriotic and evil and, you know, just a mean person, as opposed to somebody who maybe is questioning why we have to be so Christmas centric and can't, you know, focus on the message of joy and family that it's meant to be promoting. Yeah,
absolutely. You know, and forming good relationships, Emily, with people, even ones that think differently from us, is it creates a situation where we can actually have the conversation. You know, a lot of times that conversation doesn't happen because we're talking to a vague group of people we don't know, and they're talking to a group that they don't know. That's not really a productive dialogue that can happen there. It really has to be when we work together at things that we agree on, can we actually discuss what we don't agree on in a healthier way because we know each other.
That's actually a great connection. So one of our questions from an attendee is, how was your journey from Islam to humanism? And I'll just add, they said, greetings from a Peruvian Australian American in Chicago.
Greetings. thanks for the question. I went to the University of Texas at Austin here in Texas, and I am a religious studies graduate. I studied religion academically. I went to the University of Texas to prove that Islam was true, and I am here now. So that should tell you how that went. I was the, growing up, I became very religious because it was important to me what is true and what is not true. It was actually, you know, a lot of people, it doesn't matter. To a lot of people, it's just a point of identity, right? But to a lot of people, it matters if it's right or wrong or true or false. And they want to be darn sure about it. I was one of those. And so I was reading all the stuff in the mosque library that nobody read. And I was a Sunday school teacher. I was the president of the Muslim Student Association. I had a big bushy beard. I was religious, okay? And so it was unfortunately, what I didn't realize and what a lot of religious people miss is that the place to really study religion is an academic setting. And that's because a religious organization is not necessarily critically evaluating religion or alternative views or criticisms necessarily. It is promoting a religious view. And that's very different than critical evaluation. At the university, my exposure at university to people who were good and a different religion than me, that played a big part in it. You know, it's hard for you to rationalize some of the things that you're reading, some of the things that you're supposed to believe, and you just can't fathom bad things happening to the good people in your life that don't deserve anything bad to happen to them. So academic study was my process, personal experience, and with diversity from people who were different from me. And I generally believe a lot of y'all can probably relate to that. The tough part was telling the family, and that didn't go well. So it's not recommended. You have to really know what you're doing. You have to be completely independent. That means you can't be relying on your family for anything. You have to be completely independent financially, and you have to make sure that it's physically safe for you to do so. And then it takes a lot of time because they're going to go through a long grieving process. Our South Asian communities, I want y'all to know, we're very close-knit and under attack. There is a large group of people in the West that thinks that we don't belong here, that thinks that our views are incompatible with the society, that thinks that we're a threat, and sometimes they commit really, sometimes they say things that are unkind, but sometimes they do things that are unkind. And so the community, rather than engaging in a positive way, and just kind of retreats together and sticks close together. That doesn't help at all.
Do you want to talk at all about some tips to mending that gap, especially for folks who may be knowing that they're definitely going to be visiting maybe on Zoom with family this season and want to kind of go in a little bit prepared?
Oh, yeah, this is a good question. I think that if genuinely we are happy for people for what makes them happy, that sincerity is what is the key ingredient, I think. No one really cares what you think until they know that you care. So, I naturally do. Like, I'm genuinely happy for my Christian friends on Christmas. You know, I want them to celebrate. If they are Christians, okay. And they're not going to be non-Christians, you know, next week. They might as well have a great Christmas, you know. So, and I get invited to church sometimes. And sometimes I go, you know. The last time I was at a church, it was for Christmas. And I got invited to a Christmas event. And it was awesome, okay. Like, they go all out for this, you know. It's like you're getting one of the best shows of the year. So, awesome music, great performances, very nice people. Everyone's in a good mood, you know? So, I had a, and then I got a chance to make some friends. It's a good time for me. That might not be everyone's cup of tea exactly, but I have a good time. And the meeting with the pastor is only slightly awkward, you know? I kind of like shake their hand. I say, hello, thanks for having me today. And then they're kind of like looking at me. And I'm over here like, wow, the architecture here and the lighting really contributes to the mood that they've created here. And they're like wanting to see if I'm going to pray, you know? And I don't. So I think that they're watching me and they know, but that's okay. It's still a lot of fun.
Maybe for folks who have not been to a Humanist winter celebration, you want to tell them some of the highlights, either that you've experienced with your local group or that you know other groups tend to do around this time?
Oh, you know us secular folks know how to party. You know, in Houston, all the secular groups kind of get together and do a huge celebration, like bigger than what we could do on our own, you know? And it is fantastic. So, and it's beautiful to see organizations that are working on different aspects of secularism come together and say, hey, let's just celebrate who we are, you know, together. And everybody celebrates differently, but we usually have just a big party. Now, during times like this, that's very different, right? So a lot of us we're not doing the big party this year. This year is more socially distanced, it's more digital. But I think that for those of you who haven't experienced a Humanist celebration, we are unbound by what we can do. So it's pretty phenomenal to get a chance to celebrate time with the people you care about. And we generally just enjoy the shenanigans of it all.
It's true. I mean, who doesn't love an excuse to eat good food and talk to fun people and play some games? I mean, I always find, you know, the Christmas decorations, like the lights, one of the best things that I kind of wish we had for more holidays, just to, you know, kind of keep that festive look going.
Yeah, you know, Emily, I want to add to that. I celebrate Christmas. Like the whole Santa, reindeer, snowmen, like all that stuff. I have lights decked out on the house right now. I mean, my house is one of the brightest ones in the neighborhood. I have a giant tree, you know, stockings, the decor, the scented candles, the whole shebang, okay? Like I do the whole thing. And that is because I think that the secularization of Christmas is a good thing for us. It's something that we can all celebrate. Kids love it. I mean, generally this holiday has so much cool stuff all packed in and concentrated into one. I think we can all enjoy it no matter what our religious background.
I'm actually glad that you touched on kids, because that was another thing I was wondering about. I was talking to some friends who are new parents about the whole Santa Claus concept. And, you know, I did technically grow up with Santa Claus in terms of like, we had some gifts that said from Santa that were magically put under the tree after all the other relatives put theirs there. I also, you know, I'm also part Jewish. So we learned about Hanukkah Harry, who is from Saturday Night Live. But I do have some concerns as, you know, a humanist who wants to make sure that children are taught ethics and responsibility and gratitude about how we keep this Santa Claus lie going and kind of like keep adding on to it with all these extra details, especially in movies and TV shows. So I'm wondering, especially not only your opinions, but also how you kind of address that with your niece or other, you know, young people in your life.
Yeah, that's a good question, of course. Actually, a religious person once told me, Emily, they said, you know, the reason that I tell my children about Santa Claus, and this kid was getting to the age where they were questioning, like, is there really a Santa Claus? So she had like a coworker call the house as Santa Claus and tell the kid that, you know, they need to be good to get their presents and everything to kind of keep it going. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't have done that myself, but she said that the reason she does that is because she feels like that makes them more likely to be faithful. Now, I don't know if there's any truth to that or not, but she said that getting them to believe these things makes them able to believe other things as well that are more religiously oriented. And of course, I'm not a parent, so I'm probably not the best person to ask about, how do we go about, telling what to tell kids. But I generally believe in being honest and telling the truth. I don't think there's anything wrong personally with saying that, okay, like these Ninja Turtles aren't real, but they're still cool. And, these superheroes aren't real, but they're cool. And Santa and the reindeer and snowmen are not real, but they're pretty cool. And it's just another fantasy character. And kids love fantasy characters. This is, like the whole Harry Potter universe and everything. You know, my niece enjoys characters. And so whenever she and I get a chance to play, I even encourage her to come up with her own characters. Yeah, there's a lot of big money in some of the, pre-created characters that we want kids to definitely be into. But I always kind of encourage her to say, okay, well, let's create our own characters. And then we can role play and play as them. And so we created our own characters that we play as every time we hang out. And fantasy is a great expression of creativity. I think it's healthy. And no one's being lied to. Everyone understands what's going on and we're having fun. And I think that kind of having that perspective on the holidays, especially Christmas lore, might be a good way to go about it.
And I think that unfortunately we've seen from, media when you push back on Christmas too much, then some of the folks on TV start trying to push Christmas more. Like I remember the whole thing about, Santa Claus not only is definitely real, but he's definitely white. And that was on a news show. Do you have some, I honestly haven't been seeing what they've been saying about Christmas lately. So I may be out of the loop on whether things are getting better or worse, or whether we're distracted by all the other things going on in the world. But do you want to share some thoughts about, how society is, or the media is focusing the conversation?
Yeah, I think that they try to, because it fits a certain narrative, especially certain networks with a certain political view will do that. And I think that we can opt out of that game. We don't have to play that game with them. The holidays aren't about battles. They're about coming together with people. And I generally think it's very important for secular people to have a good relationship with the faith community. And the kind of place where we can come together is that we defend people's human rights, and kind of bringing it back to Human Rights Day, people's rights to believe and practice what they want. So if our friends of faith want to celebrate Christmas in a very religious way, then we want them to have the freedom to do that. And if they want to teach that to their family, and then that's what they can do if they want to do that. And as long as we have equality and equal rights, then they can make the case however they want to about what the holidays are. But at the end of the day, we all have the right to celebrate the holidays that the way we want to. And if someone wants to make a pitch to me about how there is a different way to celebrate the holidays, I may listen, I may not, but at the end of the day, I don't think that's a reason for us to not be friends. When that conflict comes up of whether it's Happy Holidays or Merry Christmas, Emily, I personally, whenever I know someone, I wish them the holiday that they're actually celebrating. Like, My parents, like Muslims, though, they celebrate Eid. And I don't say happy holidays to them on Eid. I say Eid Mubarak. That's the greeting for that holiday. And if I know a family that celebrates Christmas, I feel like I can say Merry Christmas to them. And if someone is celebrating Hanukkah, I can say happy Hanukkah to them. And if I don't know what someone is celebrating, I can say, well, I hope that the holidays bring you joy, whatever it is that you celebrate, but it's out of genuine care. And I think if that's the case, then that conversation can be made more productive. And I think at the end of the day, that there's a lot more people out there that want to have a positive and healthy holiday experience than some of the ones out there trying to pick a fight. We don't have to engage with that.
So I'm not seeing, there's been a couple of, you know, comments about agreeing with you and people sharing their stories. You know, going back to your, when you said about the values and the actual goal, I think that is something very important for humanists to both understand and promote, because that's where we not only can better articulate, you know, who we are and what we stand for, but also we can connect with other folks, whether religious or not, atheists, theists, agnostic, undecided. It all comes down to really, what are we going to do in this one life that we have while we have it? Let's see. So we're going
to... I would like to recommend to those people who are watching, you know, for the holidays, I read a book called The Atheist's Guide to Christmas. And it's a collection of short stories, writings, letters from the perspective of prominent atheists on the Christmas holidays. And one of my favorite stories in that was like an alternate universe where everyone's atheist and only a few people are religious. And interestingly, the perspective that they took was that the people who were atheists would kind of give a hard time to the religious people during the holidays. Kind of what we experience now, just kind of completely turned around. And it's a funny comedy story about an actual agnostic and him having to go meet with his overwhelmingly atheist coworkers who like to laugh at religion and agnosticism. And so they discover that he is in fact an agnostic, and they're shocked at how he could possibly think such a thing. And they have a very funny discourse, and of course they all abandon him except for one person, and they get visited by Thomas Henry Huxley, who is the person who coined the term agnostic, the ghost of Thomas Henry Huxley. And there's a hilarious exchange there in which Thomas Huxley tells them, now I figured it out. There actually is no God. And he just kind of puts it all to rest. And I wish that things could be that certain for us with our families and our coworkers and our friends. But we're going to have to just do the hard work of being good people and nice people and making good relationships along the way. And just another reminder, big picture, the world is getting more secular and we just got to keep it up.
Great. So I'm not seeing other questions, I will make sure to, Johnny, you can put your email in the chat if you want to share it. And I also will remind folks about reaching out to Oasis Network or to AHA for connections with our local groups. We did get a question about some of the American Humanist Association education opportunities, which perfectly, you know, connects to all of this. I definitely would recommend checking out AmericanHumanistCenterForEducation.org for our courses and recordings of programs such as this. Also check out HumanistCommitments.org, and that kind of gives you the 10 commitments of living humanist values, which totally reflect what Johnny's discussing about, you know, focusing on empathy and altruism, responsibility, environmentalism. You know, those are some of the ones that I always feel like come to mind first of all, and are some of the easier ones to practice regularly in our daily lives. But we are expanding on materials for that because we also want to make it easier for people of all ages to really think about how they're practicing humanism and share their values with others. So thank you again for your talk, and I will let you have some farewell and final thoughts for everyone.
Yeah, thanks so much, Emily. I'm incredibly grateful to the American Humanist Association for having me today, for their very strong leadership, for our values and for our causes. We're very fortunate to have y'all doing such hard work. And the Oasis Network is your friend for everyone that's here in that work. We think that building meaningful relationships with each other as secular people is incredibly important. That's what the Oasis Network is here to do. So we hope that you'll get a chance to connect with us. I hope that the holidays bring you so much joy this year for however you celebrate, whatever you like to do. And I hope that this year you'll just keep in mind those folks who are going through a little bit of a tough time and make sure you let them know that they're important, that they're welcome. It's very easy for us to kind of isolate and say that we're distancing, but we still need to connect with those people we care about over the phone, over Zoom, even in distance, in person, outdoors, mask, however you can. There's a lot of people out there that need our support, and we are the ones, you know, people who are here and people who do what we do. We're the ones that have got to be there for them. So thank you so much for the time today. My name is Janey Rizvi. You can learn more about Oasis at oasisnetwork.com. Thanks so much.
And I just want to add to that, not only are you encouraged to reach out to the people that you already know and love, but keep in mind all of the essential workers out there, be they medical professionals or food servers, who are still working on Christmas Day and New Year's Day and working harder than usual because of our changing times. So, you know, whether that's making sure to increase your tips or donate to certain causes or send some gratitude, please keep that in mind. Thank you all for coming tonight for this program. As I mentioned at the beginning, this is part of a monthly series. So the next one will be January 20th, and we're going to have a speaker from Smart Recovery, which is the non-theist drug addiction recovery, which we'd like to see more promoted in society as opposed to the more religious-focused programs out there.